So, my dear students, I hope you remember what you have discussed yesterday. We discussed everything about the limits, almost everything, the left limit, the right limit, and the limit. Today, we will discuss the precise definition of a limit and some definition of continuous functions. The definition of limit is like this. Suppose f be a function defined on an open interval containing a with the possible exception of a itself. That means f need not be defined on a. Then the limit of f of x as x approaches a is the number l, written limit extends to a f of x equal to l if for every epsilon greater than 0 we can find a number delta greater than 0 such that 0 less than mod x minus a less than delta implies modulus of f of x minus l less than epsilon. What do you mean by that? The meaning in a geometrical sense is given below. You see the figure, there is a curve, the curve of some function f of x that we don't know. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Remember that this epsilon and delta we can choose as small as possible. Okay, the definition does not restrict anything on epsilon and delta. So we always choose epsilon and delta as small as possible because we are asking x to be nearer to a as far as possible. So let us see that geometrical interpretation. Let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Then draw the lines l plus epsilon and l minus epsilon. You see that the lines l plus epsilon and l minus epsilon are lines which are parallel to the x-axis. Then modulus of f of x minus l less than epsilon means l minus epsilon less than f of x less than epsilon, l plus epsilon. We are using the definition of modulus of x less than a. Modulus of x less than a means minus a less than x less than a. Now, limit extends to f of x equal to l exists. Means what? Here, if you see the graph, it exists provided that we can find a delta such that if we restrict x to lie between the interval or lie inside the interval a minus delta a plus delta, then the graph of the function y equal to f of x lies inside the bandwidth of 2 epsilon. You can see that. That bandwidth is determined by the lines l plus epsilon and l minus epsilon. Sorry, there is a plus there. It is l minus epsilon and l plus epsilon. Now we will move to the concept of continuity. So what do you mean by continuous? You see this graph. This graph is a plot of y equal to or f of x equal to 4x square. 0 less than or equal to x less than or equal to 30. We have plotted that function here. This function from 0 to 30 is without any break, this moves higher and higher as x becomes larger and larger. But you consider this function h of x is equal to 0 for x less than 0 and equal to 1 for x greater than or equal to 0. You see that as there is a break, if you see the figure, you can see that there is a break when at the point x equal to 0. Therefore, this function is an example of discontinuous function. We define the continuity at a point, just like the limit at a point, we define the continuity at a point. So we say that f is a function defined on an open interval containing all values of x close to a, then f is continuous at a if limit extends to a, f of x equal to f of a. Remember that equation. So remember that this is almost similar to the limit concept, provided that there it was limit extends to a f of x is not, need not be f of a, but it be l. Here it should be, l should be equal to f of a. Now, instead of writing extends to a, we can, if we write x is equal to a plus h, then we can see that x approaches a as h approaches to 0. And that x a ile kadukka ennu parayunnathu eppozhaanu h poojyathilode adukkumbolaanu x ennu parayunnathu a plus h aayittu nammal vicharicha. So we see that the condition for f to be continuous at a is equivalent to limit h tends to 0 f of a plus h equal to f of a. Okay, അപ്പം നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞ കണ്ടീഷൻ ഈ പറയുന്ന വണ്ണും ടൂവും ഏതാണ്ട് ഈക്വലൻ്റ് ആണ്. എന്താണ് എഫ് കണ്ടിന്യൂസ് അറ്റ് എ പോയിന്റ് എ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് എങ്ങനെയാ? ഒന്നുകൂടെ പറയാം, എഫ് ഈസ് വേറൊരു തരത്തിൽ നമുക്ക് സംസാരിക്കാം. എഫ് ഈസ് കണ്ടിന്യൂസ് അറ്റ് എ ഇഫ് എഫ് ഓഫ് എക്സ് ഗെറ്റ്സ് ക്ലോസർ ആൻഡ് ക്ലോസർ ടു എഫ് ഓഫ് എ ആസ് എക്സ് അപ്രോച്ചസ് ടു എ. ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് എഫ് ഈസ് കണ്ടിന്യൂസ് അറ്റ് എ ഇഫ് പ്രോക്സിമിറ്റി ഓഫ് എക്സ് ടു എ, ദാറ്റ് മീൻസ് ഹൗ നിയർ എക്സ് ഈസ് നിയർ ടു എ ഇംപ്ലൈസ് ഹൗ എഫ് ഓഫ് എക്സ് ഈസ് നിയർ ടു എഫ് ഓഫ് എ. ദിസ് ഈസ് വാട്ട് യു മീൻ ബൈ പ്രോക്സിമിറ്റി. വാട്ട് യു മീൻ ബൈ ഡിസ്കണ്ടിന്യൂറ്റി? If f is defined for all values of x close to a but the equation 1 is not satisfied, what do you mean by equation 1? That equation 1 is limit x tends to a f of x equal to f of a, it is not satisfied, then f is discontinuous at a or f has a discontinuity at a. That means limit x tends to a f of x need not be f of a. In the case of discontinuous at a, f is discontinuous at a point a means limit x tends to a f of x is not equal to f of a. For practical purpose, we define another definition of continuity. If function f is said to be continuous at a point a, if f satisfies the following three conditions. One is f of a should be defined. So if f of a is not defined or we are not able to define, then we can suddenly say that the f is not continuous at a. If now f of a may be defined, limit x tends to a f of a may exist. That exists. It may, third condition is limit x tends to a f of x equal to f of a. So what first condition should be there, second condition should be there, third condition should be there. If these three conditions are satisfied by f at the point a, then we say that f is continuous at a. So consider this example. Now we can see that this function f is continuous at minus 3 without any hesitation, because you can see that the function is in a smooth curve at nearer to x equal to minus 3. But if f of minus 2 is equal to, you can see that 2, but limit extends to f of 2, limit extends to f of x does not exist, as limit from the right and limit from the left is differs. You can see that limit from the left, the function approaches to value 2, and limit from the right, the function approaches to value minus 1. So therefore, if the limit does not exist at x equal to minus 2. This kind of discontinuous, so since the limit does not exist, the function is discontinuous. Now we call these kind of discontinuities a jump discontinuities. Now if you see closely, see at x equal to 0, the function is continuous. And function is continuous. You can see that from the left it approaches to 0, and it f of 0 equal to 1. When x approaches to 0 from left, f of x approaches to 1. Similarly, when x approaches to 0 from right, f of x again approaches to 1 to right. So f is continuous at x equal to 0. Now let us go to the point 3. You can see that function approaches to 0 from at left of 3 as well as right of 3. So the limit is 0. But the value of the function at x equal to 3 is minus 1. So limit extends to a f of x is not equal to f of a, but equal to minus 1. Therefore, function is not continuous at 3. Now, if we redefine the function such that maybe what we do? Redefining the function by choosing f of 3 is equal to 0, the function will become continuous. So that means if we want, we can delete it, discontinuity at x equal to 3 by simply choosing f of 3 is equal to 0. Okay, this kind of discontinuities is called removable discontinuity. Whereas now consider this example 0.5. This is the graph of the function y equal to 1 by x. What happens is when x approaches to 0 from right, the curve jumps towards the positive infinity. When curve approaches to 0 from left, it approaches to minus infinity. Now we can't do it. We cannot remove this singularity. This is okay. This cannot be removed. It is not removable. Or we call such discontinuous, infinite discontinuity. That means the function attains infinity at these points. Now, what do you mean by continuity and endpoint? So, endpoint means suppose that a function f is. Before that, we will define this. What do you mean by continuous from right, and what do you mean by continuous from left? A function f is said to be continuous from right at a point x equal to a. Limit if it satisfies this following condition, that limit extends to a plus f of x equal to f of a. When we write a plus, what do you mean by that? X approaches to a from its right. Similarly, a function f is continuous from the left at a if limit extends to a minus f of x should be f of a. So you see that x approaches to a minus means x approaches to a from the left of a. Remember that our domain is the real line. So at any point on the real line, we can approach this point only from the left of that point or right of that point. Now you can see these two graphs. The first equation is the left continuous. Second equation gives us an example of a right continuous function. That Heaviside function. What do you mean by Heaviside function? That function we already defined. The function h is defined by h of t is equal to 0 for t less than 0 and 1 for t greater than or equal to 0. Now we can check whether h is continuous from right or continuous from left. We know that by the definition h of 0 equal to 0. Now limit t tends to 0 plus h of t, you can see that approaches to 1 when t moves from the right of 0. And we know that h of t is equal to 1. So limit h of t tends to 0 plus is limit t tends to 0 plus 1 equal to 1. That is nothing but h of 0. That means it is continuous from the right. But limit t tends to 0 minus h of t is, see, less than 0, h of t assumes the value 0. Therefore, limit t tends to 0 minus h of t is equal to limit t tends to 0 minus 0, that is equal to 0, not t equal to h of 0. We can see that h is not continuous from the left. Now, from the definition of continuity, we can easily see that f is continuous at a point A, if and only if f is simultaneously continuous from the right as well as from the left. Now, we will discuss what do you mean by continuity on open and closed intervals. We know that there are four types of intervals. One is open interval AB, another one is closed interval AB, another one is left open right closed interval, left open right closed interval, and the fourth one is left closed right open interval. So, a function f is continuous on an open interval AB, if it is continuous at every number in the interval. Okay, so open interval AB means what? The function will not be able to take the values a and b. So there is no problem is then. Now a function f is continuous on a closed interval AB, if it is continuous on open interval AB and also continuous from the right at a and from the left at b. What do you mean by that? See, if the function is defined on the closed interval AB, that means the domain of the function is the closed interval AB. So we don't know what is happening to this function outside this closed interval AB. So at the point A, if we want to check the continuity of that function, see, we don't know what happens to the left of A, so we take the right limit at A. So similarly, at B, we take the left limit and check the continuity. Okay? The function is, f is said to be continuous on a half open interval, that is left for A, left closed AB or right closed AB. If f is continuous on AB and open interval AB, and f is continuous from the right at A or f is continuous from the left at B respectively. Okay, now just like what we have studied in the case of limits, we can define the continuity of a sum, product or quotient of functions. The theorem is as follows. If f and g are continuous functions at A, then the following functions, the four conditions are there, is also continuous at A. F plus or minus g is continuous, fg is continuous at A, cf is continuous where c is any constant, f by g, if g of A is not equal to 0, then f by g is also continuous at x equal to A. we will prove only the second case. The other cases are very simple. Suppose f1 g are continuous at x equal to a. We know that limit extends to a f of x equal to f of a, and limit extends to a g of x equal to g of a. By the product law of limits, we know that limit extends to a f of x into g of x equal to limit extends to a f of x into limit extends to a g of x, that is equal to f of a into g of a. So, which is clearly say that f into g is continuous at a. Now, we can see that the sum and product, just as the case of limit, we can extend the sum and product law to any number of finite number of continuous functions. Now we will discuss the continuity of polynomial and rational functions. A polynomial function is continuous on minus infinity infinity. So that means you take any polynomial without any hesitation, we can say that the function is continuous everywhere in the real line. We yesterday we defined limit extends to a, p of x is p of a, where p of x is a polynomial function. A rational function is continuous on its domain. It need not be on minus infinity infinity. Now, in the case of trigonometric functions also, we can say the same thing. The function sin x, cos x, tan x, sec x, cosec x and cot x are continuous at every point in their respective domain. Now we will check the continuity of composite functions. I hope you remember what do you mean by the composite functions. We have discussed that in our classes, previous classes. If the function f is continuous at L and limit extends to a g of x equal to L, then limit extends to a f of g of x is equal to f of L. Okay? What do you mean by that? Suppose the function f is continuous at the point L, and suppose that there exists another function g whose limit at limit as extends to a is L, then f of g of x is f of L. What do you mean by that? As x approaches to a, g of x approaches to L, then since f is continuous at L, proximity of g of x to L implies proximity of f of g of x to f of L. Not L, there it is f of L. Also, theorem 13, the limit of a composite function, says another thing also. What is that? We can take the limit inside that function. That is, limit extends to a, f of g of x is nothing but f of limit extends to a g of x, that is f of L. Now let us go on to the continuity of composite functions. As I told you, you remember what you mean by composite functions. If the function f is continuous at x equal to a and the function f is continuous at g of a, then f composition g is continuous at a. The function g is continuous at a and the function f is continuous at g of a, there is a slight error, typing error. We will prove like this. Limit extends to a, f composition g of x is, you know, by the definition of composition, f composition g of x is f of g of x. Therefore, limit extends to a, f composition g of x is equal to limit extends to a, f of g of x. Since f is continuous, we can take the limit inside. So, f limit extends to a f of g of x is f of limit extends to a g of x, that is f of g of a, that is f composition g of a. That means the condition for f of composition g to be continuous at a. So, limit extends to a f composition g of x should be f composition g of a, and we proved the same. Now we will discuss the intermediate value theorem. It's again really nice theorem. We have to remember that. I think whenever we till the last, we use these theorems there. Intermediate value theorem. What do you mean by intermediate? Intermediate is between. You see that? So if f is a continuous function on a closed interval a b and m is any number between f of a and f of b inclusive, then there is at least one c in the closed interval c such that f of c equal to m. What do you mean by that? You see the figure 1. There is a curve from open closed interval A to B. The curve is given in the blue color. And f of A is equal to capital A. F of B is equal to capital B. And f is continuous. Now you take any value in that curve. We can find some C in the domain whose image is that value. Here it says that f of C is equal to W. So, if you closely read the intermediate value theorem, it says that we can find at least one C in the closed interval A. It doesn't mean that it is exactly one C. It may be more than one C. you see that in the figure B, you can see that there are two points C1, C2, C3 for which f of C1 equal to f of C2 equal to f of C3 is doubling. Okay? But now you remember that the function, continuity of that function is absolutely necessary for this intermediate value theorem. Otherwise, we have this following example. You see that this example, this given function is f of x equal to x square when x is less than or equal to 0 and x plus 1 if x is greater than or equal to 0. Function clearly is discontinuous. You see that? And you see that the function does not attain its any value there. Okay. Now, as a continuation of intermediate value theorem, one more thing which is again we wanted to study, or we will continue to study, or we will make use of these two theorems frequently whenever we study real number system or real analysis. What does it say? Existence of zeros of a continuous function. What do you mean by a function zero of a function? Suppose you have a real valued function, that means the domain and range of a function is a set of real numbers or real line. Here we, as I told you, f is a continuous function from real numbers to real numbers. So if you are able to show that f of x equal to 0 for some x, we say that x is a zero of that function. Okay. Now let us see this. If f is a continuous function on a closed interval a b and f of a and f of b have opposite signs, then the equation f of x equal to 0 has at least one solution in the interval open interval a b, or equivalently, the function has at least one zero in the interval open interval a b. What do you mean by that? See, it's very simple. It says that the curve moving through in the closed interval a b, and because function is continuous, and if f of a being a real number, it may be either positive or negative. F of b is again a real number, maybe positive or negative. So f of a is, suppose that it is negative, so its value lies in the fourth quadrant. And f of b, if it is positive, maybe its value lies above the x-axis. So what do you mean by that? That means that from this negative to positive, because the function is continuous, it should happen that function should cross the x-axis at least one point in the x-axis. You see that first here there is a circle there. At that point, function is crossing the x-axis. Now again, I said here, this existence of zeros of a continuous function, it simply says that it contains at least one zero. It doesn't mean that it does not contain more than one zero. Now if you closely see the second example, there in between the minus 1 and 4, there are three times this curve crosses x-axis. Three times it crosses the curve at x-axis. This is what I wanted to tell you. I hope you are following my argument. Kindly learn all these things. In case of doubt, again, please do contact me.